All right, we'll go ahead and get started. So before I start my talk, I want to ask you guys a couple things, or maybe just one. So how many of you are new to application security? Anyone? Just a few of you? Given this is the top 10, maybe that's a good thing. However, to not bore the other 80% of you that are in the room, I'm not going to go blow by blow through every single item in the top 10. I've done that in the past. There's videos of me doing that in the past. There's presentations of me doing that in the past. And I will give you references to all that online. So what I'm going to focus on today is what changed, or what is the top 10, what changed in the top 10 from the last release, what didn't change and why, and then for the things that did change, what are those things, why are they important, and how we got there, right? And there's always some debate about what should go in the top 10, and feel free to heckle me or throw oranges or whatever later. So let's talk about, you know, how we can make it better and how we can do it better the next time, because I also have some slides about plans on how I want to change the development process for the 2016 version of the OWASP top 10. So let me start from the beginning for those of you who are just walking in. So my name's Dave Wichers. I've been doing web security and OWASP stuff for a long, long time. Let me just introduce myself. So back at the same time I started my consulting company, Aspect Security, back in 2002, within a few months, we got involved in OWASP. And at the time, OWASP was 20 guys on a mailing list, literally. And Mark Kerfey and some other of his friends started this thing, and it was kind of cool. And Jeff Williams and I got involved. And they were talking about, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we had an app that people could test on to learn about web security? And yeah, that seems like a good idea. So we had WebGoat already. We didn't call it WebGoat. Someone else made up the name. But we said, hey, we got this thing. We spent a few weekends. And here was WebGoat. And that was our first contribution to OWASP. And then a year later, we were trying to sell our services to people. And they're like, yeah, but I'm doing the SANS top 10 for this or that or whatever. And we're like, dang it. You know, we need our own top 10 list that we could point to so people will care about it. And then as a consultant, maybe I can sell some stuff, right? So how can we do that as seven people in a consulting company? So we came up with the OWASP top 10 idea. And we published it in 2003. And OWASP went down about an hour after we published it because it got slashdotted. Hey, this is a good thing. All developers should know this list. And we just couldn't handle the traffic. But that's how the top 10 was born, because we're out there in a world that mostly cared about network security 11 years ago. And we're like, hey, we need to get the world to care about web security. And we had no idea I'd be here 11 years later talking about the fifth release of this project. And we're working on another release in 3 years from now, and so on and so forth. So then from there, the top 10, right after that, we had a conference in 2004. Mark Kerfey said, I'm busy, I'm tired. No, this OWASP volunteer thing is cool, but can't handle it. Hey, Jeff, you want to take over? So Jeff took over as chair. And at the time, we said, great, how do we make OWASP really blow up? And so we created a wiki, which made it a lot easier to contribute to the project. We created an actual nonprofit foundation in the United States, so we have an actual corporate entity. Established a board, which I'm still on, although only for another 6 weeks. I've actually been on the board for 10 years now, but finally stepping down. And then from there, we grew the chapters idea and the conferences idea and so on and so forth. And now it's 30 to 40,000 guys on a mailing list. So it's awesome when I walk into a conference like this and see so many people that care about web security when 10 years ago, nobody gave a damn. And still a lot of people don't give a damn, and we're still working on raising awareness. And that's what the top 10 is really about, right? So I've done a lot of OWASP stuff. I run a consulting company for a living to actually pay my mortgage and things like that. And I've recently helped launch a product company called Contrast, which does vulnerability detection during runtime, not through static or dynamic. And if you're interested in more details, we have a booth out there that you can go see. Anyway, so what is the OWASP top 10? It's an awareness document. That was the intent, not a standard, although a lot of people think of it as a standard. In fact, when PCI saw it early on, they're like, hey, that's a good list. So everybody, don't have that in your web apps that process credit cards. And so that gave it a lot more visibility, which is great. So some of the people kind of think of it as a standard because if you're subject to PCI, then you've got to not do those mistakes, right? Which is great, but that's not what we intended it to be. It's okay if you want to treat it as a standard, I don't care. But it's about awareness. And I think it's really, really worked, right? So think about like cross-site request forgery that came out in the OWASP Top 10 in 2007. So any of you guys have followed the actual history that we published it in 03 and then 04, and then we're like, well, am I going to do this every year for the rest of my life? No. And it doesn't change that fast anyway, so how about every 3 years? That seems like a reasonable tempo between work and change, and we've just sort of kept on that schedule, and it seems to be pretty reasonable. And in fact, a lot of vendors have checklists and tools, and they're all mapped to the top 10, and if I changed it every year, they'd just be pissed at me because they'd have to do a bunch of work every year, too. So I think it works. Anyway, it was one of the earliest projects at OWASP, and certainly the most visible, and still the most visible. So this is the top 10 for 2013, and I know it's very anticlimactic now because it's been out for 6 or 7 months, right? It's more fun when you do a conference presentation where you're like, I haven't told anyone what it is yet. Here it is. But at the same time, we want to have produced the top 10 in a open way, like every other OWASP project. So even when I did that, there's a lot of people at OWASP working on it, so it's not a secret before we come out the door anyway, and I don't want it to be a secret. Actually, I want the community to participate in what goes into the top 10 so we can generally agree that this is the right set of things to focus on, right? Not this is Dave's opinion or this is so-and-so else's opinion, right? Because the community needs to depend on it. So, you know, we don't want it to be secret. Now, what was the major change this year? That was A9, using known vulnerable components. And I'll talk a lot about that because that's the one new item in the OWASP Top 10. We also had to reorder some things. We merged something because obviously we didn't have a hole sitting there, of course. So we had to make room, and I'll show you how we did that and why. But that's the major change. So the other 9 items were actually in the old top 10. 2 items got merged into 1, and now we have a new item in the top 10. And of course, that's what everyone's favorite thing to do, and I don't put their favorite thing in the top 10. They're like, can you merge cross-site scripting and injection, because they're both injection problems, and make room for the top, my favorite item? I'm like, well, I could, but we want to shine sunshine on what we think is the most important. So if you get into the technical weeds of cross-site scripting versus any kind of injection, they're both kinds of injection problems. One's in the browser, the other's in the server. But cross-site scripting is big enough, it deserves attention and focus. So technically, I could merge them together, for example, but I think in the best interest of safety of web software, it deserves its own focus, right? And there's multiple items in here about access control. And maybe someday we'll merge them together if we need room for something else really important. What we did this time, actually, is merge 2 things related to crypto. We, one, had about data storage level crypto and transport. So data at rest and data in motion. We said, well, let's merge those 2 together and call that secure, a sensitive data exposure, A6, and that's how we made room for A9. So what is the top 10 about? It's about risks, not about vulnerabilities. Now, the first one was about vulnerabilities. We said, hey, what are the most prevalent vulnerabilities? Well, it was cross-site scripting was number 1, of course, because it's like half the vulnerabilities on the planet is that particular example, right? But as an enterprise, as a software owner or a software consumer, you don't care about vulnerabilities. We do. Technical people, we like vulnerabilities. They're cool and interesting. But when you try to explain it to someone else who owns the data, they're like, what? I don't, what does that mean? And what it means is the risk. Like, how much, what could the impact to me be if someone exploited that technical thing that you understand that I don't? What does that mean to my business? How much money do I lose? How many customers do I lose? How bad is my reputation damaged? That's what we care about. So we changed the top 10 from vulnerability to risk focus in 2007, I think. Maybe 2010, but I think it was in the 2007 version. So what we did there is we actually came up with a risk rating methodology, and there was already an OWASP project called the OWASP Risk Rating Methodology. It's not a huge project, it's just a single wiki page with some details on it. So we use that as a basis to come up with a methodology specific to the OWASP Top 10. Now, of course, this is generic. This is not specific to your system or her system or their system. It doesn't matter because we don't know your specifics. So this is in general. So it's mostly about technical risk. We have some business risk description. But what you need to do is take this top 10 into your organization and come up with your own top 10 list. And we have customers that have done that, and in fact have done it for a decade or more, and they don't even have like SQL injection in their OWASP top 10 list anymore because it's gone. I mean, you can actually solve classes of these problems and make them just go away from your organization if you're focused appropriately. So organize the risks that are most important to you and then focus on those from the top to the bottom. And they may even be a completely different order than this list and may even have different items in it. So, I mean, maybe your top 10 risk thing last week was Spring version 2 or Struts version 2 because of that vuln that came out that people were getting owned left and right. That's my number one. Let's go get rid of that vulnerable library out of my portfolio like right now because I know my competitors are getting owned by this vulnerability and I might get owned too. So let's go through the risk rating methodology really briefly. So we gather data for the OWASP top 10 to try to have justification for the order of the items in the top 10. The more data we can bring in and to back our opinion, if you will, of what's in the top 10, the more people will understand it and hopefully believe it and trust and so on and so forth. The problem is what we get today is when you get vulnerability data from vendors, and we got it from like 7 different vendors, I think, that essentially gives us prevalence information, right? So Aspect finds these top 10 vulnerabilities, and White Hat finds these top 10, and Fortify finds these, and so on and so forth, right? And every one of those things is just prevalence. It doesn't tell you, well, how likely you are to have this particular problem, or how hard is it to discover, how hard is it to exploit, how likely are people to exploit it, and what's the impact? That's all professional opinion. So we have these four factors that we consider: likeliness of existence, likelihood of discovery, likelihood of exploit, and then impact. So we have three likeliness factors and one impact factor. And we only have metrics around one of those four factors, right? And we want to get more metrics. We're going to try to do an open call for data, and I'm sort of cringing at that idea because I'm going to get deluged with data. Well, one of the things I'm going to do to help with that is I'm going to say, look, we need data in exactly this format, so you have to do some work to format your data in a way it's easy for me to consume. Then you have to publish this data publicly, and then we'll use it. So we're trying to do the big O in OWASP, open, right? So you want to contribute? Great. You format it, you publish it, and then I'll consume it. And that way it's easier for me to consume. And then everyone can not just say, well, this is Dave's private behind-the-scenes analysis of the data, but all the data is public out there, so someone else can go look at it too. We're also going to look into potentially seeing, can we get, you know, likelihood of discovery or more likelihood, even more likelihood of exploit? Like if we actually had some really good public data about what's actually getting exploited, that would help us understand which risks are actually being used in the wild. We haven't found any good repositories of data like that yet, but maybe in the next 2 or 3 years we'll have that. Anyway, that's how the risk rating methodology works. And in the top 10, we actually give you a concrete score for each of the top 10 items in these four, and we run the crank, and out comes the number, and that's how the top 10 was ranked. So you can run the math yourself and see, well, did we get them in the right order? And you know, some of the items are really close, so you know, whether it's 4 or 5 or whatever, it's up to you. But again, you should do this in your environment with your data, not mine. This is just sort of a guide. But you have your threats. We don't know what your threats are. And you have your business impacts, and we don't know what those are. This is what ultimately is important to you. You need to figure out which vulnerabilities you think you are likely to be exploited by and the impact to you. So what actually changed? We reordered 7 of them, And that was just based on the stats primarily moving up and down a little bit. We added one, as I mentioned, merged two into one, and we broadened one. And I'll explain what those are. Now, how did we build the top 10 for 2013? We used the same methodology again. Again, I try to be as brutally efficient about this as possible, and yet have people contribute. But I know it's going to be a lot more work next time, but that's because I'm going to open it up for a lot more participation. And that's one of the complaints that I received, and that's a totally fair complaint, right? I'm a volunteer. I'm protective of my personal time. So this is the way for me to efficiently knock out the top 10, and I've done it the same way five times before, and all of a sudden this time I got shot in the head for, hey, he didn't let us all participate. And I'm like, I just did it the same way I've always done it. But it has so much visibility now, people are like, look, it deserves more people participating. It deserves to be more open, and I totally believe that, right? So I'll take that heat, and that means I'm going to take some extra work next time. But that's fine. That's good. It's a good, healthy project when people want to participate in your project, and the last thing I want to do is keep people away. So we did get a couple more vulnerability providers. I think we went from 4 to 6 providers or 7 or something. We did get more data. But in the methodology for the next time, I said it's going to be more participation, an open call for data. And we did try to use weakness, like exploit likelihood as a factor this time. There were some people said, hey, I think there's data over here and there's data over there that we can use to help put some numbers behind our opinion of likelihood of exploit. Well, what I did, because I don't like monkeys on my back, is I said, hey, great, you three people that all said you think there's this stuff, you go do some work and let me know what you come up with. And if it's good, I'll include it. And radio silence. I'm like, okay, well, that's fair, I at least tried. But hopefully next time we'll get involved early enough that some people were willing to step up and say, hey, I really want to make the top 10 better, but we're going to work on this piece. And more of us will participate, and it'll be better for everyone, which would be great. And if no one steps up, maybe nothing will happen again. I don't know. But we're at least going to do the open call for data. That's definitely going to be a change. So this is what actually changed in terms of what went up, what went down, et cetera. Now, pretty much the only reason something went up or down was because the one concrete metric we had, the prevalence data, changed. Now, why would prevalence data change? Well, there's lots of reasons, right? And we don't even know. We can hypothesize as to why, right? So first off, if you add two new data providers, they find vulnerabilities in a different way than the other providers do. So I think in the last round we had was mostly tool vendor style data providers plus Aspect. So you had 4 or 5 technological, like static analysis, dynamic analysis, or like White Hat is tools with human analysis, but primarily it's automation finding vulnerabilities, right? And automation has strengths and weaknesses. So they're really good at finding some things and really terrible at finding other things, right? And then Aspect was the one consulting company in there, and we find some things really well that they can't find, and vice versa. But because of the amount of data, even though we find like authentication flaws in every app, tools don't find those flaws. So the data was kind of drowned out. Well, this time we got a better balance between consulting versus tools. And I think that caused some realignment for better or for worse. So that's my opinion of why authentication and session management moved up, is not that anything radically changed in the last 3 years. I think the fact that we had more consulting company data providers balanced the tool vendor data and shows what, in my opinion, is a more accurate order of prevalence, right? Now, I wish it was because cross-site scripting was actually going down in prevalence. I really wish that was true. It's possible it's true. I doubt it, unfortunately. I mean, cross-site scripting was number one on the top 10 for 3 times, and number 2, and then number 3. I mean, it's been around for 12 years. We've been telling the world about it, and it's still unbelievably prevalent. Because it's really, really hard to avoid, by the way. I mean, technically, one at a time, it's really easy. But trying to limit all 1,000 of them out of your app is really hard, right? So some other things did move around. Now, there's one interesting one. You notice one dropped by 3 levels. Why is that? Well, first off, the math is pretty close here. I mean, these might be a tenth off here. So you do the risk analysis, and these are like, well, you know, 2.3 and 2.4 and 2.5. So the margin of error there is probably big enough that it could be anything. But it did drop, and so I'll say I wish this is true. Maybe it's true. I think it's true. I might be totally wrong. But I think because we published CSRF, cross-site request forgery, in the top 10 in 2007, it was new, brand new. Hey, world, big problem. We've had forever, of course, but nobody knew what it was. People started focusing on it. And this is actually one of those problems that's actually technically not that difficult to avoid. So you start seeing frameworks like Spring and other things that build CSRF defenses into the framework. So the developer doesn't have to fix it one at a time. Yes, yay, that's what we want. I wish the frameworks could solve all cross-site scripting and all injection as well. And they're starting to. It's encouraging. But I really think we actually made an impact. The top 10 saying this is a problem caused change. And 5 years later, 6 years later, we're actually measuring that change. Again, maybe I'm within inside the margin of error and I'm just wishful thinking. I don't know. But I really think we've helped here. And so it actually is dropping in prevalence. We don't see it as often, right? So we made room for this new A9 by merging the sensitive data ones together. And so I'm now going to talk about A9, and then we'll talk about the other changes. So back in 2009, which is when I started writing the top 10, we actually added a new one that was in the top 10 before, and we took it out. And this was security configuration, like keeping up with patches on your server. Like, is your Tomcat up to date, for example? And is it configured properly so your admin page isn't on the internet and stupid stuff like that? And then that was in the 2003 version. We took it out in 2004 because people complained, well, that's not a developer issue or not a code issue. And we're like, all right, so we took it out. A lot of people go, hey, you're idiots for doing that. What are you doing, right? Well, you can't win no matter what you do, right? But we tried. So, but then we started thinking about it, and when we went to 2007, we started thinking about risk. We're like, wait a minute. This is a huge risk that we took out that enterprises absolutely care about. So we put it back, and we got rid of something else. I think we got rid of error handling or logging or something, and people complained about that because their tools were really good at finding error handling flaws. But as a risk, meh, didn't make top 10, right? So anyway, and in the fine print of this, this is what's highlighted here, I put in this comment that says, not only is it about updating your server and your app server and all the other stuff, you have to update all your libraries too. Because I had personally found half a dozen serious flaws in web apps because my customers were using old libraries. And I didn't have all these in my head, so I'm testing some app, and I find a struts 1 cross-site scripting right in the URL. I'm like, holy crap, there's like a million sites using struts. This is a serious problem. Quick Google. Oh, yeah, that was found 30 months ago and fixed 27 months ago, and my customer's still using it. Oops. So that was my first swing at, hey, world, pay attention to this. But it's in the fine print. How many of you guys read paragraph 2 of how do I prevent this in A6 of the OWASP Top 10 2010? 0, right, because nobody reads the fine print, right? So in 2013, I'm like, we got to change this. We got to raise it up a level, right? So, and that's where some people said, how can you have this whole new thing in the 2010-13 top 10 that we've never even heard of? I'm like, well, see, paragraph 4 of A6, whatever. We talked about it there. I even bolded the text. Big deal, right, in the fine print. So that's why we decided to bring it up. Now, what's happened? Have you guys been to an A9 talk today? How many of you guys have been to an A9 talk today? A few of you. It's good. So even in the past 6 months, people are already doing stuff about it. And I'll talk about some stuff that existed prior to publishing this, and I'll talk about some things that have already come out in 6 months to help with this problem. It's not a solved problem by any means, but people are paying attention to it, which is great. That's, again, this is an awareness document, right? So what's the problem, right? Well, here's our code, right? And we're supposed to analyze this, but you know that's an iceberg, right? Where's all the ice? It's under the water, right? Well, imagine the rest of the iceberg is your components. And that's reality. There was a panel in this room this morning that talked about 80% of people's code is down there. And I'm like, nah, that's a low number. I think it's more like 90 or 95 or something. But it's a huge, huge number, right? Now, a lot of that code never gets executed. So it's not like we got to spend 90% of the time looking at the bottom and only 10% looking at the top. No. But we got to make sure we know how those libraries are used and exposed at the top. And if they're vulnerable and that vulnerability is exposed, that's when we care, right? So that's what we're seeing. So I got 80-20 because this slide was written a couple years ago, but I really think it's more like 90-10 now, right? So, but it's just not our opinion, right? We knew there's a problem years ago, but we're like, well, let's get some data, right? So a company called Sonatype happens to be like 15 miles away from Aspect in Columbia, Maryland, just by happenstance. So we know their CEO and we know some of their employees. And so we had lunch with them one day and we're like, ah, this is a serious problem. And you guys run Central, right? Yeah. Can you give us some data? Sure. So we said, here, give us data on the top 25 most popular libraries and the 6 most popular security libraries, or something like that. Maybe it's 23, whatever, I'm not sure the exact. But that's where we got the 31 we chose. Mostly popularity in the top, a few security ones. Like two OWASP projects, you got a SAPI and any SAMI are in here somewhere. And we said, give us all the data of what was actually downloaded in 2011. Turns out it's 113 million downloads, I think, right? Well, Sonatype knows exactly what version of every one of those libraries you downloaded, and they know which ones are vulnerable, because we know that, what's published CVE on that library. And we figured out that 26% of those libraries were vulnerable at the moment of download. Not a year later when you're still using it, but literally the moment you downloaded it before you included it in your project that eventually went to production someday. Well, obviously that's not a good idea, right? But nobody's really paying attention. Right now, open source is exploding because it's free. Well, that's what everyone hopes, right? It's free, great, right? The problem is there's a tax that comes with it that nobody wants to pay. And that's upgrading those libraries when vulnerabilities are fixed and you're using them. We all like free, we don't like taxes, right? Universal truth, if you will, right? Well, unfortunately, there's something that comes with this. Now, your choice is don't use open source, and then you don't have to pay these taxes. Great, but now you gotta do a ton of development that you didn't have to do before. So you pay one tax or another, pay your choice. Make your choice, right? Now, this isn't even measuring the number of vulnerable libraries in production. One thing that would be interesting to figure out is of the 74% were safe, how many of them were safe 12 months later? I bet you it's like a third of them have known vulnerabilities a year later. My guess, I'm just big wild guess, right? We could actually measure, we could go back to Sonatype and get that data and find out what's it like a year later for these libraries. But I bet, you know, a third of them, I wouldn't be surprised, right? Or a quarter, whatever. So it's a huge problem. So we published a report, the link is down there, you can just search on unfortunate reality of insecure libraries, it's also referenced in the top 10, and you can make your own judgments based on the data that we did our analysis on. But obviously it's having some effect because there's a bunch of talks about it, like Ryan Berg from Sonatype, who's the company we did a talk, and you talk to the vendors, there's vendors out there, and they go, oh, we have a new feature in our whatever tool that does library analysis, and it tells you about vulnerabilities, and that's good. And I'll tell you some free things you can use as well, because we all like free. Again, we're all about free. That's how we got here in the first place. We like free. But I'll give you some free to help you with this problem a little bit. Again, nothing's ever totally free. So these are incredibly common problems, because people aren't paying attention. They grab a version, it works, move on, right? In fact, some of these apps aren't even under development anymore. Well, now what do? I mean, you start thinking about the update problem, it's a really hard problem, right? Okay, well, it's a new major version, which means the API has changed. I can't just drop in a new one. I gotta rewrite my code. Oh, that's work. It works today. Why do I want to break all my APIs and rewrite it? Well, pay your taxes or be insecure. That's your choice, right? And what's interesting in the last 3 years is the number of major framework vulnerabilities has been accelerating, right? So I'm from the Java world primarily, and so Struts and Spring are the favorite poster childs of this problem. They've each had a I own your server level vulnerability at least one a year for the past 3 years. In fact, Struts has had like four in the last 3 months or something. Or maybe there's one patch that fixed four kinds of that kind of vulnerability. In fact, the day some of the new Struts release came out, some major websites got owned within 12 hours of the release coming out because the bad guys are going, ooh, new release. Fix CVE, foo, great. Let's reverse engineer the difference between the two versions, find the vulnerability, scan the internet for everyone using Struts version whatever, and then bam, root on that box, game over. And it was literally happening within 12 hours. So the bad guys know about this too. I mean, the unfortunate reality of the top 10 is that when we say, hey, world, this is a serious problem, the bad guys are like, ah, cool, new stuff for us to use too. But the cat's out of the bag at that point. We can't do anything about that, right? So what's the impact? Well, it depends on the nature of the vulnerability and is that vulnerability exposed to your user, right? The bad thing about UI framework vulnerabilities like Struts and Spring is usually they're directly exposed to user interaction. So you don't have to do anything in your custom code to make it so that the bad guy can exploit that vulnerability. Every user of that library is exposed because that interface is exposed to the user, right? Now, if you have a vulnerability in like log4j, like if you have a certain special set of weird characters that they grab and they log and that causes a problem, maybe they would get to that level of log4j, but that's buried back in the bowels and it's much harder to exploit. So not all vulnerabilities are created equal. So when you find out there's a vulnerability in a library you're using, figure out, well, A, how critical is that app? B, did the library change? How many versions out of date am I? If I'm like one or two versions, probably no big deal. Drop a new one, probably okay. But a lot of times, you stop paying attention, it's been 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, now you're 12 versions behind, now you want to upgrade and you're like, oh crap, all kinds of stuff has changed in the last 12 months or 24 months. Much more risk to upgrade. The other thing I think is a tip of the iceberg, to use another iceberg analogy, is I really think the actual publicly reported security fixes is the tip of the iceberg. I really think for every CVE out there, there's 100 no CVEs that are real vulnerabilities they got fixed in libraries that they're not telling you about. And it's their best interest not to tell the public about it if they don't have to, because they're just advertising to the bad guys, we fixed these 7 flaws, please reverse and engineer, figure it out, put it in a Metasploit, known whoever you want, you know, tomorrow, right? So if they get something reported internally, they find it themselves, and they can just fix it and make the reporter happy and it never gets to CVE, that might actually be better. Now, again, that's not, oh, big OWASP open, but at the same time, you don't want to lay out the red carpet for the bad guys. So, I don't know, that's a tough problem. But you can figure it out. If you read their change notes, you'll usually see stuff like fixed input validation issue, right? I wonder what that meant, that they weren't validating their input. Oh, they had cross-site scripting or they had SQL injection or whatever, right? So there's hints usually, and sometimes it's explicit, but there's hints that there's security issues. So I would generally advocate upgrading to every new version all the time with my security hat on. But that's even a double-edged sword too, because if it's a totally new version of something, that means there's a whole bunch of new code. And that might have new vulnerabilities that the old one didn't. So now you're like, what do I do? I don't know. You either analyze it to make yourself safe, you just trust it, I don't know. In general, I think you're better off just upgrading, and probably all in all, you'll probably be more secure that way than not. But it's not easy. Again, the open source tax, right? So what can you do to avoid this? Well, ideally, step one is knowing which ones are vulnerable, right? So hopefully you have automation that says, you have these 37 libraries in your project, and these are the 17 of the 37 that are out of date. And one of them hasn't been updated in 3 years, and the rest are only 6 months old, so they're not so bad. And then, oops, this one's got a known CVE in it. You better, you know, fix that right away. And even 6 months ago, when we first wrote the top 10, the amount of automation for this part of the problem was pretty minimal out there. But actually, there's been a bunch of automation built, including an OWASP project that I'll talk about in a second, right? Otherwise, by hand, you'd have to do it. Or periodically, what do? Can you go to CVE and read and go, oh, struts issue. I wonder if I'm using that. So what we need is an ecosystem, and I bet you we'll get close in the next few years, actually, is we need an ecosystem where CVEs get reported on libraries. That data ends up in central. And then when you download the library, it says, you know, what CVEs did it fix? Or it says, hey, this library has a CVE on it, by the way. You probably don't want to use it. Right now we don't have the infrastructure, but we talked to Sonatype, and they're the guys doing the talks here, so maybe we can say, hey guys, why don't you help us? If they put CVE data right in the download, then you can look at it and go, whoop, warn me whenever I download a library with a CVE in it, and then I can go figure out, should I upgrade or what have you. We need to get this data aggregated together in some way, and right now it's mostly by hand or by some custom vendor tools. So you can do some stuff. Some of it's by hand now. There's some automation. I definitely think automation is going to move forward. Now, once we have awareness, then the hard part starts, actually upgrading. And it's not just the libraries you use, but it's the libraries your libraries use, and the libraries your libraries that libraries use, and so on and so forth. If you've seen like the dependency tree for like Spring or Struts, it's like, you know, 50 libraries. I'm using Spring, which means I'm using 50 other libraries, and you don't even think about it. And they might have a vulnerability that's exposed by Spring to you. So they got to upgrade. So Spring uses the upgrade, and then eventually you upgrade to that version, and it's really complicated. But I'm sure vendors will start working on stuff in that space, which is great. That's what we want. So here's a simple example that existed pre-OWASP Top 10 2013. So there's this thing called the versions plugin for Maven. How many of you guys use Maven? I know we're not a lot of developers in the room, but hopefully your organizations are using Maven. If they're not, they should be using things like Maven or things like it, right? So with Maven, we just put this little plugin. We say, run this plugin on my build every time I build my software, or every night, or once a week, or whatever schedule you want, right? And it goes, look, hey, you've got all these libraries. And it goes, hey, which ones are out of date? Well, there's two green ones here, it's hard to see, and the rest are red. And that's pretty typical, actually. It also tells you what's the next incremental update and the next major release. So it gives you some information. That's good, right? Now, what this doesn't tell you is which ones have CVEs. I'd really like to know that, right? Anyway, this is super easy to set up. You can Google in 5 seconds, not 5 seconds, maybe 5 minutes, you can get set up. Not a problem, right? So you can run this automatically all the time. There's even a switch, which I don't recommend, that says automatically upgrade me. So if you want to live in the bleeding edge, just turn that on and go, and you'll be on the latest version of everything all the time. But shit will break, right? Every once in a while your build will break, and you're like, what happened? Oh, we just upgraded some library, and the interface changed, or there's a bug in it, or something, right? So I don't recommend that automatic update thing, but awareness is step one, right? So at least this takes care of a lot of the grunt work, right? And even better would be a column that says CVEs. And I can imagine that'll be there in a year. It can't be that hard. We're already gathering the data, so let's make that available. And then you could get an email every time a CVE number shows up in this column. So this runs every night and you don't even look at it. CVE shows up, bing, an email, oh, CVE in Spring version foo. Oh, good, now I gotta go pay attention. The other thing that I haven't touched at all is, do you even know what libraries you're using in your apps? And if I step back from that, do you even know what apps you've got? Right, this sort of starts to get back to some fundamental AppSec problems. Do you know the apps in your portfolio? How many people are really confident that their organization knows every web app that they've built and deployed in their organization? Zero. Okay, yeah, we all have a problem, right? And that's fundamental, that's step one. Then, what are all the libraries being used in every one of those apps including the apps we don't even know exist. We need to get there. So we need an app inventory, and then we need a library inventory, and then when the spring version FUBAR vulnerability comes out, we can go to our dashboard and go, show me all apps using spring version FUBAR whatever, and it goes, boom, these 37 are using it. And you go, oh wow, these are 5 in production on the web. Let's get those fixed like now. And then these are internal, let's get those fixed next week or whatever. But we don't even have the ability to ask that question today. That's kind of a different problem, but it's related. So the top 10 was out like a month. And this guy said, hey, I want to create OWASP dependency check. And I don't even know what it is. If you're in the room, wave your hand. But it's cool. So he wrote a little tool, and he looks at your libraries, generates a hash, sends that to Maven Central, finds a match, and then he goes off to his database, and he finds out if there's a CVE on it. And if there is, he says, hey, there's a problem. So this is open source. So the data is already public somewhere. So we just got to get like versions to use it and other things to use it and build an ecosystem around that. And there's going to certainly be commercial solutions that have more bells and whistles. And then there's some basic free solutions, which we all love, that we can use as well. But this is awesome that we've got this. So this is baby steps, but let's go, right? All right, so that's the end of that new one. So let's just talk about the few other changes, and I'll be done. So we merged the two topics related to crypto, transport security and storage security. So we just call that now, I don't even remember what I called it anymore, but sensitive data protection, right? And so sensitive data in transit or at rest deserves protection, and it's up to you guys to decide what protection that needs. PCI, for example, has very clear guidance on a credit card and what to deal with that, right? And in your business, you have to decide what makes sense for your data, right? So anyway, we merged those together. Not that we don't think they're both important. They are. They're really important. But we also wanted to make some room, and that was the least important of the top 10 that we felt comfortable merging together, right? So that's that. Now, we also changed another item. We used to have failure to restrict URL access. So that's basically function level access control. So I've got a URL, and the URL specifies the function I'm invoking, like get account balance or whatever, and I didn't protect it. I missed the access control check for some reason, right? So that's what it's really about, is function level access control. And we were very specific in the terminology, but not everyone uses the URL to specify the function. Sometimes the parameters specify the function, or even a combination of parameters specify the function. So we just broadened the terms to be more inclusive. And I think this is much better, right? So whether it says get account balance in the URL, or it says a function equals get account balance, I don't care. It's the same problem, right? So that's all we did was broaden it a little bit. Not a fundamental change, but it's more inclusive, and I think that's appropriate, right? So that's it in terms of changes, right? In the future, like I said, we're going to try to get more data with a public call, but I'm going to do some work first to define a format so that it's easier for me to consume, and it also will make it easier for other people to do analysis. Like, I would guarantee that if I just published the data that I was given in the top 10 this time and gave it to any one of you and you did your analysis of what the actual top 10 ordering was, your answers and my answers would be very different, because the data was in such different format that I had to make all kinds of assumptions and merge things together that I thought were similar, because your 27 categories are different than their 49 categories and so on and so forth. So I just had to do some work. And so I did my best effort, and I came up with some stuff, and it seemed kind of right to me, and we reviewed it with a small team, and we're like, yeah, nothing seems really wonky with these answers, and that's what we came up with. But hopefully what we can do is come up with a standard format that says, look, let's you report maybe these 40 categories of vulnerabilities, and if you have others, report those too, but you got to use these 40, and if you have things that are in both or whatever, you got to deconflict them and merge them or whatever, so that if someone else did the same analysis that I did, you come up with the same results. And it would be a lot easier for me to do the work, too. And if we do it all public, then everyone can look at it. Now what we did do is all the data for this time is public. But what we did was after we got the data said, you know, this data should really be public. And I'm like, you're right. I totally agree. Great recommendation. So I went to all the vendors and said, if you want to, will you please make your data public? And we'll put a link to it in the top 10 so people can go look at it. And half of the vendors already had made it public. And others had not, like my company had not. So we said, oh, we'll do it, sure. And then it took us like, you know, 3 weeks of work to produce a risk report that was nice and pretty and met our brand and all that, but made the data public. And then some other vendors as well. And other ones had already had it public, so that was fine. So that data is all public out there today. You can look at it. So if you guys have any ideas, like, again, I work for, you know, a year on it, and then I rest for a couple years, and then I work on it for a year. So anytime you got any ideas between now and then, let me know. I'd rather have the great idea when we're 5% in or not even in at all than 95% done, because you might have a great idea, but it's too late. And then you're like, oh, darn. And then you got what? You got 3 more years to wait before we can think of your change. So we did get some great comments, and we did incorporate as many of them as we could. Some of them it was just a little too late to do. We intend to incorporate them this time and make a better project and get more people involved. So hopefully you guys find it useful, your customers find it useful, whoever. And I would love to see what it's like in 3 years on A9 to see how much has changed. I mean, I want this to be easy. So we got to raise awareness. Vendors build stuff. Free guys build free stuff. You guys start incorporating this. And in 3 years, your life is a little better. I don't think it's going to radically change. And maybe in 6 years, like with software CSERF, that we've got automation that deals with a lot of this stuff. Again, it's not going to completely go away because it's a super complicated problem. But if it's a big complicated problem, there's money involved because the effort on your part, so vendors will help, consultants will help, and we'll automate as much as possible, and your life will be easier and more secure, which is, of course, the whole goal of all this stuff, right? So more security, less cost. That's what we're always trying to achieve. Anyway, that's all the time I have. If you guys have questions, which I'm sure some of you do, we'll take questions for a few minutes. So go ahead. Yeah. Sure. Sure. I mean, we do have some business impact wording in the top 10. We just don't score it because we don't know how that makes sense to you. So we do have a little block in there. But the other challenge is we do everything in one page. You've seen it, right? How do you talk about a top 10 item in one page? It's really tough, right? Yeah, yeah. Sure, absolutely, right? You talk about SQL injection, and they're like, okay, they can run SQL code in my database. Sounds bad, but what does that mean? Oh, they just stole all your credit cards, they stole all your passwords, or they deleted the database. Ah, okay, I understand what that means. And then they take action. Yeah? How does it track with the developer's guide? I don't coordinate directly with them, but usually they'll coordinate the developer's guide and the testing guide and the code review guide back to the top 10, just so you'll know how they are linked together. I do link directly to all the OWASP cheat sheets, by the way. If you guys aren't familiar with the OWASP cheat sheets, you should be, because they're really, really good. There's about 40 of them, and I'm not sure they're all really good, but a number of them are. Particularly the ones that the top 10 points to, like SQL injection, cross-site scripting, CSERF, those are all really, really good cheat sheets. And those are similar to the developer's guide, except shorter. Yeah. Any other questions? All right. Thank you very much.